Chapter 23. Mary versus Martha. A couple years ago, I released my first independent album. It was titled Jonah. At that time, I had just unofficially joined the staff at my church as well. It's a very busy time. So a thousand things going through my head because the church was hosting my album release party, and they were also launching a young adult ministry. It's amazing how you can get caught up in all the busyness of ministry and lose sight of actual real-life opportunities to reach people in a deeper way, interpersonally. This episode was one such case. I almost missed out on a chance to directly help someone. Like I said, that moment in time for me was a culmination of a ton of hard work to release my first album independently. I'd financed the whole thing strictly through crowdfunding through my fans. I was taking on most of the responsibility of the release by myself, whereas in the past, I had had a label and a team to handle most of the admin with my previous records. I learned it is a ridiculous amount of work to release your own album independently. This is a big turning point for me because a year or so prior, I was ready to quit. A career reinvention was happening before my eyes, culminating in this night, my album release show. It was about to happen. Again, I was definitely busy with all the day-to-day work, especially on that day. I had a big night in front of me and I was lost in the details, setting up, preparing for the show, etc. And I'll never forget, the first CD I ever sold was to a sweet retiree lady. She must have been in her 70s or 80s. She just walked into the church, headed straight to my table, and said she wanted to buy a record. I was a little confused, so I informed her, like, you know, the music is rap. She said she knew that and she loved my music. It was such an ironic moment. I mean, selling my first independent disc to an octogenarian. I reflected on it right then and there, just for a few minutes, quietly. The whole scene reminded me of the Martha versus Mary moment, where one of these women sat down at the feet of Jesus to learn and just to know him better. The other one was doing things for Jesus. Anytime you're involved in ministry, you can find yourself in the same situation. In other words, you can spend tons of time doing things for Jesus and not spend any time actually with him. If you don't know what I mean yet, just keep listening. Minutes later, this random kid walks in off the street. He was looking around, seeming lost. He had a look on his face like he just needed to talk to somebody. And in that moment, I thought, well, you know, I'm going to refer him to one of the pastors. The last thing I need to do right now is counseling with some kid over some issue he's probably had problems with 1,000 times. After all, he could be a crazy person. I mean, after all, I had a ton of stuff to do, so much going on. I wasn't even really a pastor on staff. But then he said, I was just wondering if I could come in and pray. So I told him to go right into the sanctuary, and if you want to pray, just to go for it. He walked into this big empty room and he sat down alone. And I went back to just setting up my merchandise. And something hit me. It was like the voice of God rose up above all the noise in that moment and reminded me, what are you doing these things for? Are you doing them for me? Well, what are you actually doing? That's my heart, that kid in there. So I walked into the sanctuary and it was dead quiet. There was nobody else there. I sat down and I said to him, hey man, you seem distraught. Like, are you okay? Is there anything I can help you with? He just looked up at me and he said, I don't know how to pray. And I want to give my life to God. It was like in that moment I thought, man, I would have completely missed this because I was so busy doing my Christian rap ministry. I was so busy setting up for my big release show that I almost forgot why I was doing it in the first place. At the end of the day, it's still about people. This kid was why I do what I do. I came so close to passing up the opportunity. All I ever wanted to do was just reach people. Not necessarily the masses, but primarily individuals. So I talked with him and I listened to him. And I asked, I said, have you ever read the Bible? He said, no. I said, well, can I just share some verses with you? And I just began to walk him through what it meant to surrender your life to Christ. And after I finished explaining the basics of salvation to him, I said, do you understand what these things mean? He said, yeah. I said, do you understand without Christ you're lost and there's a penalty for your mistakes? He responded with, yeah, I understand. I said, well, do you understand now that God is asking what you'll do with that? Are you willing to turn from your life and give everything to him? He responded, yeah, I want to. I said, well, listen, can I lead you in a prayer to do that? And right there in that moment, we prayed. Then he looked up and said the exact same thing I said the day after I gave my life to Christ. He said, something feels different. I gave him some more information about the church, how he could continue to grow, and then I said, okay, man, God bless you. I'll be praying for you. Just like he came in, he disappeared. I mean, it was that fast. I never saw him again. It was such a gut check. It was as if God was asking me directly, what are you doing this for 20 years later? You're still at it, but what are you actually doing it for? Are you doing it so you can sell some merch and some CDs? Are you here just to play for a packed crowd and feel like the man? Or is it still actually about people? Is it still about people that are hurting who need to know that there is an answer? It wasn't an accident the kid came in like he did. He was no different than I was when I was 15. It was a reminder directly from above.